Okay, so we are going to learn about Truman and the Cold War. This lecture goes along with chapter 26 in the United States History AMSCO textbook. So let's go. I want to start with a general overview of the time period and talk about the positives and the negatives of this time period. This is really important because what you'll see is that in the immediate post-war period, the 1945 and through the 50s, we have the roots of both the incredible post-war prosperity that the United States experiences, but also at the same time, the seeds are sown for the decline of that prosperity. So it's not as though it's dominoes, one and then the other. They actually both kind of get going at the same time, and we'll see why what that means and why I'm saying that. So on the positive side of the column, after World War II, the United States emerges as the pretty much unquestioned leader of a new post-war order. Yes, the Soviet Union is around, but there's really no comparison in terms of the leader of the democratic and capitalist world. It is the US. However, part of that hegemony or leadership role is rooted in a policy of containment, which, while it does effectively slow down or stop the spread of communism, it results also in the United States supporting right-wing strongmen abroad who fight, right, left-leaning or communist tendencies. And also civil rights abuses at home, and we'll see examples of that. There are many post-war federal programs that help accelerate prosperity, most famously the GI program. However, there's a lot of racial restrictions that are still in place through New Deal policies. We also have the GI Bill, for example, is administered locally, and in places that are have negative racial attitudes, you have obviously a racial bias or discrimination that we see in terms of how it's administered. The post-war economy booms, that's great. However, union rights also decline. So part of the engine of economic prosperity begins to decline, right? The rights of workers. This obviously very famous image, Dewey defeats Truman, the false headline, thinking that Truman's unpopularity was going to lead to his loss in 1948, turns out not to be the case. Okay, New Deal backlash. So people are anti-communist in this period, and this divides the Democratic Party. People who are who accuse the Democrats of being soft on communism, this becomes a very potent political tool, rhetorical tool. And you have the Democratic Party divided between two different wings. The progressive and New Deal wing, which is Truman is the head of, wants to continue and expand New Deal programs and extend that into social and racial justice kind of terrain. And then you have more conservative Southern Democrats, right? The traditional power base of the Democratic Party, which obviously they are not too keen on the idea of racial equality for African Americans. So Strom Thurmond here in this example, the States' Rights Party, Southern Democrats, South Carolina. Interestingly, right, this is in the 1948 is the States' Rights Democrat Party when they run for president. Strom Thurmond was a senator from South Carolina. Fun fact, who is the South Carolina senator that follows Strom Thurmond when he leaves office? Lindsey Graham. Right. So Strom Thurmond was in office from the late 1940s all the way until 2003. So kind of incredible that. Okay. And then we have the rise of Sunbelt conservatism, right? The Sunbelt being the region of the country that stretches from Florida through Texas into the Southwest in particular, Southern California, Arizona, New Mexico. Nixon is from Southern California. He gets his political, the limelight shown on him in this time period because of his role in the Alger Hiss case. Reagan, also from California, and then Barry Goldwater, who we'll learn about later, who's from Arizona. And it's a new genre of conservatism, and it's new because it's not like Eisenhower. Eisenhower, in terms of the history of the Republic, modern Republican Party, 20th and 21st century, Eisenhower is kind of an exception. Post-Eisenhower, and in particular post-Reagan, the Republican Party has a very particular states' rights, small government outlook. Okay, post-war success. So the Servicemen's Readjustment Act of 1944, also known as the GI Bill, supports 15 million vets, right? These are vets coming back from war, want to re-enter the U.S. economy. They receive low-interest home loans. But, of course, again, as I said, administered at the local level, these are often racially discriminatory. For example, out of the 67,000 mortgages that were issued under the GI Bill in New Jersey alone, so 67,000 in the post-war period are issued to veterans, less than 100 were for non-white veterans. Right, so this is a staggering number, and the same goes for college funding. Right, largely this is whites only. The idea is that the historically black colleges and universities are the institutions that black veterans should go to. They're very quickly overwhelmed by applicants. They simply cannot accept them all. And the thinking is you're not going to give a loan to a black applicant that's trying to apply somewhere else, right, a non-black university. So this is really important, not just because it's like an inherent racial inequality in the program, but also because what is the result of this, right? You have white veterans, young men, who are buying homes in the suburbs, moving out of cities, right? Trying to attain the American dream. They're going to college, they're getting education, so they're not only working in blue-collar industrial jobs anymore, they're getting better white-collar or management jobs. And black veterans are not given these avenues, right? So again, in terms of the seeds being sown for a lot of urban decline and decay and the racial animosity that we'll see in the 1960s, it starts here. Okay, suburban growth. Levittown, New York, 1947. Cheap houses, this is Levittown in the background. We see here Levittown named for William J. Levitt, right, who is the developer. Another Southern California example is Lakewood. Lakewood, California is developed in 1954, and the term that is coined is the Lakewood model. This is a neighborhood, a subdivision, where it doesn't have any local services, right? So Lakewood says, we want garbage services, and in the 1930s or early 1940s, the idea is if you're a city, you have garbage collectors, right? That they're on the city payroll. You have sanitation workers. You have water, sewer. You have police that are on the payroll. The Lakewood model says we believe in the small government, so we're going to contract out for all of that. We'll ask Long Beach and Garden Grove and Seal Beach to put in bids, and whoever's the cheapest, we'll say, okay, now you can come and be our cops. You can come and collect our trash or what have you. So this is something we're going to see more and more of in terms of the philosophy of the Republican Party in the post-World War II era. Again, white vets move to the suburbs, not black vets, as I mentioned. And then the shift to the Sun Belt, again, the Southwest in particular. And then the rise of Sunbelt politics, right? Nixon, Reagan, Goldwater. I know this is repetitive from the last slide, but it's important because it's not only a political shift, it is a geographic shift as well, right? So more people move there and vote for folks like Nixon and Reagan, and then they subsequently have more political power. Okay, post-war problems. Civil rights, again. Dixocrats and Republicans don't want the civil rights legislation to be advanced. Taft-Hartley is an anti-union law that is passed in 1947, the beginning of the end in terms of the strength of American labor unions. The power of unions will be slowly chipped away at during the period that we're studying, period eight. But this is really the beginning, right? So very, very early on. We can, when we look at the 1970s, we'll see really American unions and the auto, AFL-CIO, the auto makers unions in particular, heavy hit by offshoring and automation. But it really begins, that downward trend begins in the 1940s. And then communists, right? Obviously real ones abroad and then fake and real ones at home, right? So as the meme suggests, right, we do on the one hand have freedom of expression, but you know, not if you're a communist in the 1950s. Or even, you know, if you're accused of being a communist. So many of the people who are accused by McCarthy and others were not actually communists. But that accusation was a very strong rhetorical and political tool. So if you want to kind of take someone out, if you want to try to hurt someone's career or job prospects, and they're left of center, this is going to work. Okay, post-war threats. Marxism. So just a kind of moment to pause and define terms here. What is Marxism or communism, right? So the idea is that the workers own the quote-unquote means of production. So this is in Marx's language. The means of production are the private property that makes stuff, right? Factories, supply chains, all of the kind of industry that produces industrial goods. It shouldn't be held by, owned by private citizens. That's capitalism, right? That private individuals own the quote-unquote means of production. In communism, it's the people. Right. And then, of course, the thinking is the government is supposed to represent the people. Does not happen in the Soviet Union, obviously. So this does not mean that you don't have a house or you have to share your toothbrush. The abolition of private property means that this, Ford Motor Company would be, owned by the government. That the airlines, actually, interestingly, because currently with the COVID-19, their airlines are asking for a mega bailout. So the thinking would be if you were, took a communist point of view, you would say, well, okay, we're going to give you all this money, but now we own you, right? The means of production. Okay. And then the thinking is, of course, that in Marx's theory, that communism comes after capitalism, right? So Marx, far from an antagonist of capitalism, Karl Marx actually loved capitalism. He thought it was the most efficient system for producing things, for moving goods across the world. He just thought it was terribly exploitative, and that in his theory, eventually it would get so bad. Again, Marx writing in the 1850s and 1860s, the system would get so bad that the workers would rise up and seize the means of production, right? There's some stuff that Marx doesn't anticipate, such as, right, capitalist economies integrating welfare policies and other kind of pro-worker things. But that's for another discussion, a kind of political discussion. So that's what Marxism is. And part of Marxism is that it's global, right? That workers of the world unite, that it's to have a communist society, you need to have a global communist society. And this is why capitalist countries see it as a threat, right? Civil rights. Okay, so civil rights is, right, people of color demanding equality. I have the little asterisks here because people of color is not a term they would have used, right? Anyone would have used in the 1950s, but it's the contemporary term. So, well, while ahistorical, it's accurate. This is seen, obviously, Dixiecrat, Strom Thurmond, and others see this as a threat to traditional Southern values. And it's also associated with communism, right? Because what ultimately, if you're a person of color demanding, your equal rights, you want equality, sounds a lot like communism. So in the South, that rhetoric is a very potent tool to fight civil rights. Union demands. What are they, right? They want to continue on with the progress of the New Deal. And Republicans, meanwhile, want to push back the progress of the New Deal. New Deal policies, housing, healthcare, and welfare. I have, obviously, this is the slide is post-war threat, so you must be wondering, well, okay, Marxism is a threat. I get it. Civil rights are a threat to racist Southerners. I get it. Union demands are a threat to business owners. I get it. But what are these New Deal? What is housing, healthcare, and welfare? What are these a threat to? Well, this is a very important bit of American magic that we see in this time period and also very much alive today, is that these policies, civil rights, union demands, and then demands for housing, healthcare, and welfare are associated with Marxism. And that is the kind of explosive rhetorical device that is that begins in this time period. And again, as I mentioned, is still around today, right? If you're, you know, Bernie Sanders, for example, his political positions and his political opinions, he calls himself, right, a democratic socialist, but really he's further to the right than FDR was, certainly by 1940s standards, right? But you say, oh, you know, $15 an hour minimum wage is communism, right? That's a kind of welfare, healthcare, universal healthcare, or healthcare for all, communism, et cetera, et cetera. So moving these policies into this rhetoric is a very potent tool. In the back is the Tsar Bomba, which is the largest explosion of any bomb, a Russian test, the biggest. The strategy for the Russians, just as a kind of nuclear history aside, I'll go back to the next slide here while I talk about it. The Russians were not good with navigating missiles. Once we get to ICBMs, intercontinental ballistic missiles, the United States had very, very accurate missiles, so we didn't need large explosions. The Soviets, in a typically Soviet way, their aim wasn't good, so they just made the bombs bigger and bigger. So that's why you get things like the Tsar Bomba, massive, massive megaton bomb. Okay. The Cold War. The Cold War is an imperial conflict. It is a conflict between two empires. Yes, the book identifies the Soviet Union as a communist growing empire, but the United States is a growing capitalist empire, right? Since 1898, the United States is expanding globally and wants more and more influence, because the more influence the United States has globally, the better for capitalism and the better for the American economy, the theory goes. The more influence the Soviet Union has globally, the better for the economy of communism and the better for the Soviet Union. So it's communism versus capitalism. And as I mentioned, and as the book suggests, this is rooted way back when, right, in the actual revolution, and then the general anti-communist fears of the pre-World War II period. There's a reason the United States didn't get involved in the Spanish Civil War. There's a reason why the United States and European countries let Germany militarize the way they did, let Japan expand the way they did, because they were actually more afraid of communism. Truman Doctrine. This is the United States providing aid to stop the spread of communism. Marshall Plan. I'll go over these in more detail later on in the presentation. And then the real conflict. So these are ideological things here. And then the real conflict is that the Soviet Union sees the United States' containment policies as aggressive, and they respond by pushing outward with things like the blockade of West Berlin. And then the United States responds with the Berlin airlift. So you have this kind of back and forth between two emerging empires is going to be the conflict that that defines the time period. I will end the lecture there for now, and then I will create a part two lecture in which I go into the specifics of what's happening in Germany, what's happening with containment, the Truman Doctrine, Marshall Plan, etc., etc.